Christmas.
All right, I'm slow, but I have started the Hangout. It appears I'm live now. I'm going to try and select this question and answer it. And Karen Harlos asks, am I going to be running as chair again? The answer is I will be running as chair again. I think I have at least one competitor I know about and one that I think might be running, but I haven't heard confirmation yet. But my wife has graciously allowed me to run as chair again, and so I will be.
Your Christmas be
I want to apologize to everybody who tried to get into the first version of this Hangout because it didn't work right for a lot of technical reasons. Google's Hangout on air thing is not as intuitive as I think it ought to be. No offense to Google, but it's a little bit tricky. So we did this again. And I hope that everybody enjoys it. Just making sure that I get the right links out there.
Frosty the Snowman is a fairy tale, they say. He was made of snow, but the children know that he came to life one day. There must have been some magic in that old silk hat they found. When they placed it on his head, he began to dance.
Any other questions? I don't see any other questions. I see two people watching, one person watching. That's so sad. Is everyone else having a good Christmas? Does anyone else have any other questions?
Frosty the Snowman knew the sun was hot that day, so he said, let's run and we'll have some fun now before I run away. Down to the village with a broomstick in his hand, running here and there all around the square, said, catch me if you can.
Led them down the streets of town right to the traffic cop. He only paused a moment when he heard him holler,
stop, because old Frosty the Snowman, he had to hurry on his way. But he waved goodbye, saying, don't you cry.
So anyone have any questions about big libertarian news today? The big news that I got today was that John McAfee, the founder of McAfee Antivirus, apparently announced that he wanted to seek the Libertarian Party nomination for president. It is going to be an interesting convention in Orlando in May.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Man, it doesn't show signs of stopping. And I brought me some corn for popping. The lights are turned way down low.
So, man, I need more questions. I think that these live things, they don't work so well without the questions. So if you got questions, hit me up.
But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm, and the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbye. But as long as you love me so, let it snow.
It's Libertarian Party Christmas with your chairman, Nicholas Sarwark. I am listening to Pandora. It has a pretty sweet Christmas carol station. I have the station set to Dominic the Donkey Radio. If you've never heard Dominic the Donkey, it is probably the coolest Christmas song that you've never heard of. Let me see if I can find that pretty quick here and play it for you, because it is pretty impressive stuff.
with Infiniti. Now through January 4th, lease the Infiniti Q50 for $309 a month.
I did see your question, Karen, and the answer is I am going to run for chair again. I think that I have a pretty good shot to win, but, you know, who knows? Maybe people will like someone else better, but I will run for chair. Right now, the big surprise as far as who's announcing for the nomination. One, there's a surprise that Johnson's taking as long as he is to announce that he wants to get our nomination. It's looking like January, February before he announces. John McAfee, the antivirus guy, just announced that he wants our nomination. There's a big USA Today story about it. I think it's exciting. I mean, you know, it's up to the delegates who they decide to pick, and if they pick John McAfee, then we'll do the best to support him, just like we would with any other Libertarian candidate. But I think that it's exciting that there's so many people who want to get the Libertarian Party's nomination this year.
The stocking of little Bill. Oh, just see what a glorious bill. Here's a hammer and lots of tacks, a whistling ball and a whip that cracks.
Oh, oh, oh,
who wouldn't go?
Oh, oh, oh,
who wouldn't go? Up on the housetop, click, 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 down through the chimney with good Saint Nick. Housetop reindeer paws, out jumps good old Santa Claus, down through the chimney with lots of toys, all for the little one's Christmas joy.
Ho, ho, ho,
who wouldn't go?
Ho, ho, ho,
who wouldn't go? Up on the housetop, click, 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 down through the chimney with good Saint Nick.
Ho, ho, ho,
who wouldn't go?
Oh, oh, oh,
who wouldn't go? Up on the housetop, click, 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 down through the chimney with good Saint Nick.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. With the kids jingle belling and everyone telling you be of good cheer.
I was going to say, I can't find a Liberty cap without the fur, so this is as good as I can do. I do have my special Libertarian Party t-shirt. I spent the $50, sent it into Wes Benedict. He sent it to me. It's the long sleeve with the legalized freedom on the back. It's pretty awesome, but the hat's not an original French Liberty cap. I'm going to answer this one because it's come up and I understand. I've talked to the candidate who I'm sure you're referring to. I've talked to you. I've talked to a lot of people. Here's kind of the way I look at this as far as a candidate who potentially repudiates part of the statement of principles. it's up to the delegates. If the delegates at convention decide that they don't want to nominate a candidate who repudiates part of the statement of principles, then that's up to them. If they decide that they're willing to nominate somebody because they're a good enough candidate and they don't like the statement of principles, that's up to them too. As chairman, I'm kind of like a referee. All I do is make sure that nobody gets in any fights and everybody gets a chance to speak and all of that. So from the chair's perspective, unless there's a clear bylaws violation, I don't mess with candidates. I don't mess with, you know, you aren't allowed to run for the nomination. I think that's up to the delegates to decide what's most important to them. Yeah, Andy, I do want a Liberty cap. If anyone finds me a Liberty cap and sends me one, I'd send you a lovely thank you note or a link to where to get one. But for Christmas Eve, it's Christmas hat. That's pretty much all I got. This is a coin margarita, which is the only real margarita to have. It's basically one part of lime juice, one part of Cointreau, and two parts of silver tequila. It's pretty much the best margarita of ever. And as far as the back of the shirt, let me stand up, turn around, show it to you. It's got the big Legalized Freedom and the Libertarian Party logo. I hope that looked good, because I can't see behind me when I stand up. But I hope to see all of y'all at the convention in Orlando. John McAfee, man. I got an email asking for comment from that USA Today reporter, John Swartz, for the article that he printed today. And I was very happy that Doug Craig, a fellow board member on the Libertarian National Committee, took that for comment, because then I didn't have to. You know, John McAfee's an interesting guy. He definitely has some stuff going on that is useful to the party. He's a very colorful character. At the same time, he's got a lot of baggage, which is not out of the norm for the Libertarian Party. And so I think that, you know, the McAfee candidacy definitely adds a lot of interest to our nomination. That's good for us as a party. And honestly, it comes back to one of the things Karen asked about. I trust the delegates. If John McAfee has too much baggage, I trust you, the Libertarian Party delegates, to come to the convention and decide who you want to have represent you. And if you decide that a guy who's, you know, got too much baggage isn't good for you, then that's fine. And if you decide that that kind of press is more important to you than, you know, the baggage, then that's fine too. It's up to the party to do what they want to do about Mr. McAfee. But I welcome him to the nomination race, and I hope that we have a good convention in May. Jim, as far as people who are affiliated with the old parties, the Democrats or the Republicans, either one of those old parties, I appreciate the fact that they are willing to join the Libertarian Party. I think that that's important that they would join the Libertarian Party. I think that the Libertarian Party offers an opportunity to actually support freedom that their old parties don't offer at this point. I think that it's important to make sure that the people who have decided to come over to the Libertarian Party have actually decided to come over to the Libertarian Party. I've talked to some former old party members, including people who were elected senator in the United States Senate. And I've made it very clear that when you want to seek the Libertarian Party's nomination, if you're not a libertarian, it's going to be hard to get the nomination. It's not that we're going to stop you. You can come to the convention. You can try and get the nomination. But people aren't going to elect you if you don't have libertarian ideas. Even going back to a candidate like Bob Barr, where people said, you know, he's not libertarian enough, he at least was on the national committee. He tried to be libertarian. If you don't do that, it's not going to work. You know, you can come and try, but it ain't happening. And so I've been very forthright with anybody who's approached me about what it takes to run as a Libertarian candidate and told them what it takes to run and what you have to do and what you can't do. Karen, when it comes to being part of the Libertarian wing of the Libertarian Party, I think I am doing my best to represent the Libertarian wing of the Libertarian Party. I recognize that there are people who disagree with me on a lot of issues. Most recently, immigration has been a big one. There's a lot of Libertarian Party members who identify as Libertarian, who are, I would say, Libertarian, who just can't get on board with the party's position on it. And that's something that we have to deal with. But when you want to come down to all of your freedoms all the time, that's where I'm at. You know, and everyone else is either closer or farther away from that. And the fact that you're not here yet, that's not a problem for me, as long as we all recognize where we're trying to get to. From the bylaws question that Karen's asking about whether or not the LNC could disqualify a candidate, the LNC has the power to disqualify or repudiate a candidate, even one who's been nominated by the national convention. The fact that they have that power doesn't make it at all likely that they would use that power. For the most part, the national committee is going to defer to the will of the delegates unless there's something that shows that the delegates just, I guess, didn't know what they were doing. But if a candidate comes into convention, says what they're about, and the delegates decide to nominate them, then the national committee is most likely to just go along with that. And Andrew Craig asks a really good bylaws question, one that's much more likely to come up. If Jesse Ventura, who is not currently, as far as I know, at least last time I heard, a member of the Libertarian Party seeks the Libertarian Party nomination without becoming a member, how does that work? And the answer, I need a big swig of margarita for this. The answer is basically that the bylaws require that one be a member of the Libertarian Party to get the nomination. And so as chair, in that situation, I would rule that that nomination was out of order. Unless somebody could show me documentation or something that shows that he had actually joined the Libertarian Party, he would not be eligible to be nominated for the nomination of Libertarian Party.
We have technical difficulties. 6:45, 7:15.
Woo! And there's Ava. Ava says, hello and Merry Christmas. Can you say Merry Christmas? Can you say Merry Christmas? Say Merry Christmas. Ava's not going to say Merry Christmas to any of you. She won't even say Merry Christmas to me. And I'm her dad. What do you see? Hey, Daddy. You're being a weirdo. Valerie, you want to say hi? Okay. Valerie doesn't want to say hi. The power behind the throne stays behind the throne. Just hand off the child. To answer Karen's question, I will not chug the margarita. It is delicious and eminently sippable, and so I will continue to sip it. And also, just as a bonus answer, my wife said that she would kill me if I chugged the margarita because I'd probably be less than pleasant. Merry Christmas to you too, Andrew, and Merry Christmas to everybody. This is sort of a last minute thing, and as many of you know, that we had some technical difficulties with the first try of it. I just thought it was nice to, you know, say hi to the other Libertarian Party members out there and say, hey, you know, we're a pretty normal political party, which is not normal for political parties. You don't see Reince Priebus or Wasserman Schultz popping up on Google Hangouts on Christmas Eve, drinking a margarita, saying, hey, how are you doing? Mark asks, kind of, what will the Libertarian Party do to attract new voters and increase our presence in national elections? The first step is we're going to get out there in all 50 states. We're going to be a presence to make sure that everybody in the United States understands that they have a Libertarian option to choose for president and for other races down the ballot. That's kind of the first step. The other thing that we need to show people is that this is really in the second option, not the third option. A lot of times people have thought that Libertarian Party is like a third choice for you. It's really the second choice for you, because if you vote Republican or you vote Democrat, you're really just picking the same thing. You're picking the same people that are run the same Congress. They're going to push through the same omnibus bill that has the same spying provisions. So it's really old parties or new parties. That's your choices. So we are going to try and get people to understand that we are the second option for politics. Andrew says we should post the next one of these on the National Party Facebook page. We probably should. This is kind of a test run, so I didn't want to make it a big deal, but we should do something. Maybe New Year's time we can do something that's got a little more advance notice, get some more viewership, and, you know, still going to drink margaritas because they're just delicious. Andrew asks about ballot access and how it's going. So where we're at right now is we have a ballot access drive in Oklahoma that is set to put the Libertarian Party candidate on the ballot in Oklahoma for the very first time since the year 2000. That's a big deal, because if we can get Oklahoma knocked out either this year or January, February, we're on track to have 50 state plus the District of Columbia ballot access, so that every single American will have a Libertarian Party option, a Libertarian Party candidate to vote for. And that's a pretty incredible thing that we haven't been able to do for over a decade. And so that's kind of where we're at with ballot access right now. Karen asks, am I planning to run for a political office in the future? I feel like I'm pretty political as chair. I mean, it's the chairman of a political party, that's a political office. But as far as public office, outward facing stuff, I've talked to some people who are encouraging me to run for a public office sometime in the future. And I think I'm going to reevaluate that after the next term as National Committee Chairman, which I hope starts in May of 2016 and then runs through the end or the summertime of 2018. And that's when I'll evaluate whether or not to run for an outward facing political office in 2020 or continue with party office. So Karen asks, what do I think of the state of the Dallas Accord? This needs extra margarita sips. So for those who don't know, the Dallas Accord is an agreement that was made, I believe, in 1980 in the Libertarian Party that basically says that the anarchists and the minarchists aren't going to fight. And just for people who aren't familiar, anarchists are people who believe that the ideal situation is the one where there's no government. And minarchists believe that the ideal situation is one where there's a minimal government. And what the Dallas Accord, Karen points out, it's 1974, not 1980. Fair. What the Dallas Accord basically says is, if we're all moving towards less government, then we're not going to argue about where we're going to get to. the anarchists and the minarchists can be on the same train up to, you know, next to the last stop, and then the minarchists get off and the anarchists keep going to Super Freedom Town. And that accord, that general disagreement, was resolved by basically saying that in the platform we don't say that government has to exist. We don't ever say specifically government should be there for this thing or government should be there for that thing. We always talk about it if government exists or when government exists or a proper government should, you know, things where we're talking about if you got one of these things, then they should do these things. I think the Dallas Accord is in a good place. You know, I understand there's some anarchists who think that there's some language that kind of pushes towards the maybe you should have government. I don't think that's the case. I think that we're still in a place where we have a large political party that can absorb people who are both wanting to end all government and the people who are wanting to end most government. I think that we're still able to work together, and I hope that the Dallas Accord continues. You know, if we have to have an Orlando Accord, let's do it. So I killed all my questions because, you know, I try and be responsive as a chairman. That's kind of what chairmen do. So I'm going to drink more margaritas, check on the other social media channels to see if anyone asks questions that I don't get to see on the Google Hangouts. Looks mostly like people are commenting on my family's Christmas tree, which is pretty awesome, I should say. Oh, new question. Select. Andrew Craig asks, what are your thoughts on the perennial efforts to attack the Koch brothers and or the LP by reference to our 1980 platform and David's VP candidacy? Discussed on the recent Morning Joe interview for, I think, the first time in a while. So here's the deal. The Koch brothers run a large oil company. They also have a lot of money, or so I've heard. They had a split with Libertarian Party over the presidential nomination in 1984, where Berglund took the nomination over Edward Ravenal. This is old history, but it apparently means a lot to them. You know, the way I look at it is I was five, like literally five, 5 years old when that happened. And so I don't put that much stock in what happened back in 1984, but the Kochs kind of left the Libertarian Party, went and did Cato and some other stuff. They fund some other libertarian organizations within the movement. They do a lot of really good work, but this breakdown over that stuff is just nuts. And as far as the 1980 platform, it's not that bad of a platform. You know, getting attacked by it is the same as anytime someone says, well, we're gonna attack you on the drug thing. You know, you oppose the drug war. And it's like, no, you're the crazy people, not us. You're the people who want to put somebody in a cage for what they put in their own body. That's not a thing we want to do, but why don't you explain your crazy position about why you want to put someone in a cage over what they put in their own body? So I don't think that the efforts to attack the Kochs based on the 80 platform are legit. But I also don't think that the Kochs should stay out of the party just because of the 84 schism. That's not really worthwhile at this point. So if anybody has any contacts within the Koch organization, have them give me a ring. I'm pretty easy to find. Let's try and mend this rift. I'm going through questions right now, deleting Andrew's because it didn't actually ask a question. So Karen wants to have an Orlando Accord to replace the Dallas Accord. I think the Dallas Accord is doing fine, but Orlando Accord is fine. You know, do what you can. We'll see how it goes. Karen asks, why so far has the party really pushed our rights on poly people? I guess there's a typo in there somewhere. So polyamorous people, you know, here's the thing about Libertarian Party. We don't care what you do with your own life as long as you don't hurt anybody and you don't take their stuff. That's kind of our deal. You don't hurt people, you don't take their stuff, you're good. So if you want to have two husbands, two wives, eight girlfriends, I don't give a shit. The Libertarian Party doesn't give a shit. From polyamorous people, we're like, do your deal, don't hurt anybody. That's all we ask. We haven't gone out and pushed on it as a press release kind of thing because there's not really a hook for it. It's not that we don't support it. It's that, you know, we kind of take the opportunities when we get them. People ask me this about my open letter to Muslim Republicans regarding Donald Trump. It's not that I like Donald Trump. It's not that I like Muslims. It's not like Republicans. It's, you know, the opportunity existed to talk to these people at this time, and so I take the opportunity when it comes. Kind of the same thing with polyamorous people. It's not that we don't support them. It's that we got to find the right hook to push out publicly. But I encourage all poly people to become libertarians. I encourage all people who support poly people to become libertarians. We are the only people who really care about what they're trying to do. Mark Baker asks, what does the Libertarian Party plan to do to support a nationwide concealed carry effort? I don't think we have any particular plans to support it. You know, I carry a gun periodically, so that's kind of my little piece of the puzzle. But the truth is that the NRA is kind of doing a lot of the spade work to push concealed carry nationwide. And we've got it up to in the mid-40s for states out of like 50 states. That's pretty good. So it's not really something where that's a place where we're putting a lot of our effort or pulling out a lot of our resources. But we support it. We just don't spend our money or our time on it. Does that make sense, Mark? So my wife tells me my time is up, which is probably true because it's way past 7:15. And so I'm going to sign off here in a couple minutes. Or now, as my wife says. Last question, hate speech laws. I think that hate speech laws are ridiculous because whether or not you dislike somebody doesn't really affect whether or not you should be punished for what you do. If you do something bad to somebody, you should be punished. If you don't do something bad, you shouldn't be punished. If you say bad things about somebody, you probably shouldn't be punished most of the time. And so hate speech kind of tries to blur that line, and I don't like it. I don't think a libertarian view would be to like it. So I'm going to log off. I appreciate everybody who watched the Christmas Eve with the chairman. It's, you know, kind of a silly thing, but I appreciate y'all coming on to watch. I appreciate all the questions I got. I hope that people watch this broadcast and realize that we're, you know, a real party with real people who are really your chairman. I mean, I'm a dude who's, you know, not overly special. Trust me about that. Last couple questions. Karen has said, thank you for answering. Happy holidays to you too, Karen. Merry Christmas. I understand that you you celebrate. Even if you didn't celebrate, just say Merry Christmas. Or don't say Merry Christmas. Doesn't matter. We love each other. That's important. So I hope that you have a wonderful Christmas and a wonderful New Year's. Jim, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Mark, thank you for watching. I really appreciate it. Have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Everybody have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We will try and do another one of these again. If you liked it, post it on Facebook, spread it out, share it, you know, see if people like it. You know, if they like it, then I'll do more of them. If they hate it, I ain't going to do them again. So that's kind of where we're at. I'm going to stop the broadcast now, finish my margaritas, go hug my kids. To my brother Josh, thanks for watching. That's awesome. And happy new year to you, buddy. All right. So I will talk to y'all later. Thank you so much for watching, and have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.